Okay, let's get over to you.
Scoot your ass over.
Put that on that side. Symmetry, you know?
Just,
okay.
It's a cushion.
Just
around.
Okay.
Where, no, because we're trying to make the couch symmetrical.
Oh, I see.
Oh, okay. I didn't see the point.
That's because Chris is in the way. Bugger off, cat. Go on. It's good.
Enough of your cattiness. All right. So if a monster does call, my general response is like, hello, Winchester Brothers? Help! Not what this kid does.
Which is generally go, I'm going to be grumpy because grief. What is it this year?
With grief.
This is year of depresso film.
2016, fuck it.
Well, man. It's kind of hard to be grumpy.
Yeah, but it's like it's prescient. It's like, cinema went, you know what? We better start pre-production in 2014 and script polishing in 2015 to really fuck people up at the end of 2016.
I'm way ready to deal with grief right now. This is the year of grief. Yeah. This is the year of, like, feeling it. And A Monster Calls is the Neil Gaiman-esque version of said feeling grief. I'm Chris Cox, by the way.
Richard.
I'm Frank.
JC.
Chris.
And yeah, this is A Monster Calls by J.A. Bayona, who was The Orphanage, was like his first big shot across the bow, produced by Guillermo del Toro. A lot of people still think that's a Guillermo del Toro film, and it is
they
not.
Are wrong. They are wrong, yes.
Although it's certainly in the flavor of that, of his Spanish films. But
In a way, so is this. You can see why they would be simpatico.
I would compare this more than anything else to Pan's Labyrinth.
Yes.
For sure.
Except of less, you know, child murder and things.
Or in a way, because, I mean, this is adapted from the novel by Patrick Ness of the same name. There's also something very much of the original book of The Iron Man, upon which The Iron Giant is based upon.
Yeah. Well, there is something in the way it was presented visually and as far as, like, trailer form that made me interested in this versus, like, the BFG, where I was like, fuck that, I'm not going to see that.
Yeah, no, this is childhood darkness.
You and everybody else.
For the record, I kind of like the BFG.
I did too, but this has more, like, obviously more... Right.
Well, this is more artful. The BFG was more, like, sort of, like, effect-driven, you know?
Yes.
It felt like more of a Robert Zemeckis film than it did a Steven Spielberg film, to be sure. But this is the story of Connor O'Malley, played by Lewis McDougall. And this may be is this his first film?
I'm not sure, I think it might be,
but it's certainly the first film he's been noticed by. Young boy, his mother Felicity Jones, with now two really great turns in cinema this year. RER Rogue One review.
Watch your kids.
Who is dying from cancer, and he has his own problems above and beyond that, even, where that he's, you know, he's a thoughtful child. He's a creative child. And so, of course, bullies attack him and are trying to beat him up. So,
Could you stand in for the author?
It could be. One night...
Never.
Oh, one night, a yew tree in the distance comes to life, voiced by Liam Neeson, who says, I got stuff to say to you, but I unfortunately can only speak in metaphor, so I'm going to tell it in the form of three stories, which are animated here.
Mm-hmm. Beautifully.
Yeah. Beautifully.
Oh, my God. Oh, lost cool. in them. Oh.
And it's kind of, one of the weirdest coming-of-age stories I've seen in a while, in that it really is kind of like almost, it's hard to dive through the levels that are going on here until the third act, which makes it all so very clear of what this kid is being told, how he's being instructed to, it's time to be a man, despite how young he is. And I was very impressed by this.
Mm-hmm. It reminded me, if anything, of the British horror movie Paper House. From the 80s.
I've been chasing down that movie.
You finally found someone else who knows what Paper House is.
I haven't seen it.
It's the same sense of, how do you process terrible things that have happened to you in your life through, you know, a degree of the supernatural. Mm. And it has that kind of energy to it. I mean, and there are little things that are in here that I think are so beautifully done without being overstated. Not least the fact that the yew tree in most Northern European cultures, it's the tree of birth and death. And that, yeah, the fact that the monster is a yew tree that comes to life, and the monster is amazing.
Yeah,
this is this is what an Ent should have looked like.
Hold on, because the Ents looked incredible. Sorry, I'm getting wood just thinking about it.
Silence, child.
I felt like that was less a look at my pun and more a sort of a ending of sleepaway camp.
That was not right in the slightest. But you know, much like Jackie, which we talked about, and Manchester by the Sea, this is about how do you process grief. Now, this is very different because this is very clearly aimed at children. It's interesting, actually, my wife and I were recently talking about Inside Out, and our, her take on it was, Inside Out is great if the worst thing that has ever happened to you in your life is, oh no, we've moved somewhere else in our comfortable
now,
white bread life.
Shush!
Hush while the point
are
is made.
Are you seriously criticizing Inside Out?
Yeah, hush while the point is made. The point here is that this is like, you know, the worst thing that can happen to a child.
I'm going
to
put it in my Santa hat just to be nice.
Is the death of a parent, particularly in this case, because Connor's father, played by Toby Keeble, is basically absent. So he's really only being raised by his mother. His grandmother, played by Sigourney Weaver, has started turning up and trying to interfere in the life because she's feeling like she's, you know, she knows she's going to have to become the primary caregiver, which he is rejecting at all levels. You know, this is real grief. This is when you've been through something serious in your life as a child. I think this kind of film is actually really important for them. So it does. This isn't just there's a sad story and sad things are happening and there's a monster. This is a parable about real childhood trauma, about you know, terrible things happening, and how does this kid deal with
it? Healing through story.
Yeah.
Like, which is always something that hits a point with me where I get Verklempt just the same way I do with Noble Sacrifice. I'm like, they're talking about healing stuff through using your imagination and stories. I get all like choked
life
up.
And art imitating. Yeah.
Every single time. And I felt like overall this got to where it wanted to be, but I did feel like it wasn't until the third act this film played its strongest cards. There was certainly the first two acts of this there's a little bit of meandering. There's a little bit of this is going on a little too long. And there's a little bit as well of the three stories. Like, why are we waiting so long to get to those points once they announce that's what this movie's about?
Like, aimlessness.
Why is there so much in between it?
So
it's a shame because
you mean there's a payoff in the third act for what's happened in the first two?
No, I do, but it's a little dry in the first two. Is what I'm saying. And Sigourney Weaver
is too much fluff.
Oh, she's so great.
Is so great in this film. But I felt like once again, it's not till the third act that I really started to appreciate how great Sigourney Weaver
really
is.
It's always from his perspective, and it's what he sees. You know, you're not really meant to like see have her big cathartic moment until later, because it's his story.
You guys are being very quiet. What do you think?
Well, I mean, the thing is, I think probably the best aspect of the film, at least for me, is like the animated segments, and it's kind of the fables and when the Liam Neeson tree is talking to the kid. I think those are all great, but it's during the first two acts, which I think. Which I really preach about the film, because it's not only Connor's grief and what he's going through, but it's also the grief of everyone else. Yeah, Sigourney Weaver's character, which is kind of iffy to a certain extent, even her accent, it kind of goes. I'm big on the accents. Like,
what was
if you
her
can't nail
supposed
it,
to be?
I don't know. Certainly was it British? I mean, you'd be the expert.
There were moments that were there was like, you're trying some weird.
Get away from him, you bitch.
Yeah, pretty much. She had a little,
that was not a good British accent. I'm
what the
aware.
Hell was Catherine Hepburn doing here? That was weird.
We all appreciate Catherine Hepburn as one of the greatest actresses ever lived, but she's terrible at accents.
Yes.
Yeah.
Which is not my point being not a slam on Sigourney Weaver in and of itself.
No, of course.
Helen Mirren was busy, but we got Sigourney Weaver. And yeah. She's
done. Helen Mirren would have been great.
You wouldn't. Don't even get him started on Helen Mirren. Charming. Go.
Yeah. So when Sir Gordy Weaver isn't being kind of a stereotypical, you know, evil British, you know, grandmother, I mean, she does have those occasional moments when she does open up to Connor. Yeah, that comes in the third act. But also when Connor has this kind of angry episode brought on by one of the fables that the tree tells him. It's a very it's a very angry scene with Connor, but then it becomes very quiet, and you see that grief in that moment with Sigourney Weaver's character. Yeah. And yeah, despite the accent, you know,
it's our best scene in the movie, without saying words.
Yeah,
yeah, it's the big the thing that
it helps when she doesn't try to do an accent. Yeah. Yeah. That's what we're boiling down to here.
Yeah, just act with your face. Yeah, no, this movie is best when it's nailing grief, like you said. Like, I remember seeing it at Fantastic Fest. One of the things I was telling people, this movie did its job as far as nailing grief, because although I've been fortunate enough in my life to still have both of my parents, watching this, I did kind of imagine like holy fuck, what's it going to be like when I do lose them? Even though I'm going to be a grown man, it's going to be devastating.
For the record, gonna suck. I'm telling you from personal experience, it'll suck ass.
And so I think it nailed that. And I can only imagine how a kid processing this must be like, fuck. Like,
it's confusing enough as it is at that age anyways. Yeah.
And I think there's something so specific about this style of storytelling of like, in and of itself, nothing's going to heal you more than hearing a tale that's not going to resonate with everyone, obviously. Right. Otherwise, Sandman would be the best selling book of all time. But it is going to hit people so hard who like that sort of thing that I think they're going to find this a kind of definitive movie for that type of storytelling. Yeah.
I do like this side point,
JC.
Yeah.
Nailing Grief is actually the name of my pitch for the Wedding Crashers sequel, where it's 20 years later and all their friends are dying off and they just keep going to funerals and nailing the widow.
I'm giving you money right now.
I think
Grief was one that's of the sub endless. It was one of the characters like, oh, okay, it's probably Toby Jones.
I was going to say, I do like this method of kids' movie storytelling where it's like, filmmakers are telling kids, hey, suck it up because this isn't going to be a nice life forever. Eventually, life is going to suck, and it's going to hit you really hard.
Yeah. Yeah. It is kind of almost overwhelmingly like,
yeah.
Stop it with your whining. All right, let's go to final thoughts. Chris Herman, once again, leading the final thoughts.
Yeah. Yeah. I really enjoyed the film. I felt that even though some of the performances weren't as front and center like Connor's, everyone had their moment in the movie. Like even Toby Kebbell, which I think was nice not to see him in a motion capture suit for once. It's like he doesn't need that to provide a good performance. I also thought Felicity Jones was good. Like her scenes with Connor were fantastic. Sigourney Weaver when she finally is in that third act when they reveal that she's not a typical evil granny. Great. But yeah, for me, probably my favorite moments of the film are the fables that the Liam Neeson tree tells Connor. I think those are all great. They're not very happy. They're very kind of, grim fairy tale esque. I guess kind of like Neil Gaiman. But yeah, I really enjoyed the film, and I think it's a perfect kind of dark family film. And I think you can probably show a 10-year-old this, and they wouldn't have an issue with it. You know, kids are more mature than I think a lot of people give them credit for. So yeah, I'd probably give this 8.5 broken branches.
Let's hear from Frank.
I think that I agree with you. I think kids are way more resilient than anybody gives them credit for, and I think this movie really speaks to that. I love how deep this movie went, deeper than you ever thought it would go. When I first sat down, I thought, man, it's a shame that this movie doesn't come out in the summertime, because it's such a, it's an original thought, but I think it's too deep for summer. I love that. Chris Herman said, I love that each of the fables, really dealt into the grayness of life. Yeah. That there was nothing black and white about any of the fables. And that, the monster represented so much. It represented Connor's fears. It represented, that those areas of life that he was scared to embrace and didn't understand. And this is a film about grief, but it's also about, more than that, it's about the end of childhood, the beginning of, what comes after young adulthood. And I thought that it was, illustrated so beautifully, just in its script and definitely in its visuals. I think the side performances are remarkable. I loved Felicity Jones in this movie. You know, her, you know, she's the entire time she's trying to keep his childhood alive. She doesn't want what is happening to her to affect him in any way. And of course it is, but
she actually made my best supporting actress list mine too. This year.
Yeah, she did. I love that when she's still at the very end, trying to hold back tears. She's like, if you need to break things, just break them. It's okay. And, you know, when she, it breaks my heart when she says, I wish I had 100 years to give you. Because that's, you know, every parent wants to give their children the moon and the stars. And they can't. And this movie shows that they can't. And does it beautifully. So I give this probably 9 out of 10 impeccable watercolor drawings, which I just can get lost in and look at every day.
Let's slide over to JC.
I think I've gone on record whenever Felicity Jones is in a movie that we've reviewed. I'm a huge fan of hers. I don't think she's ever disappointed me in any movie she's been in. So anything she's in, I'm all in on. I can't wait to see Rogue One. And so, yeah, in this one...
It, for the record, it's good.
Yeah.
That's what I hear.
I concur.
Yeah. And, yeah, in this one, she's... you know, not able to do as much because she's obviously going through some things, but she still, like Frank said, nailed her role here. Yeah, I liked it all around. The biggest strength, like I was saying earlier, and how it really nails the grief and makes the viewer really kind of feel what that kid is feeling and really understand what must be an impossible thing to understand a kid going through, unless you've gone through it yourself at that age. I think this showed and that.
Thankfully,
really well.
Most of us have not had to go
yeah.
through that.
And yeah, going through that, I mean, it must be a motherfucker. But yeah. Yeah, I would give this.
That's true, Jason.
Curious, yeah. Curious choice of words. Yeah. Phrasing.
Yeah. I would give it 8 out of 10 branches.
Dick?
Didn't think of anything.
I don't pull that out very often, just every once in a while. I was waiting for you to disagree with me on Rogue One to pull it out, and you didn't, so I was like, okay, I'll...
You don't pull out your dick very often. Well, I think we're all glad of that on camera.
Yeah.
I think this is a really special, elegiac, tragic little film that does deal with grief in a kind of in a very intimate way, you know, by using this supernatural metaphor. It's, you know, bar Sigourney's terrible accent, it feels very British, but in a very accessible way. It ties into, I think, you know, those kind of British pagan traditions very subtly without making them super explicit.
Okay.
And I think that works extraordinarily well. Liam Neeson is great in this, even though you never see him.
Yeah.
The monster design is just spectacular and feels natural and organic. There are some big...
It's nice to see him branching out.
There are actually a couple of big special effects sequences in here that really... you kind of forget because they're so engrossing and so built into the storyline. But even though this is a small story about a child dealing with grief, at the same time, the whole thing... you know, the world explodes around it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And it pulls those things together without ever letting the story of this one child and what he's dealing with ever slip away from what is absolutely central and pivotal. And a lot of that comes down to Lewis McDougall, who is just amazing in this. So it's one of the best child performances I've seen in a very, very long
while. It's solid.
Yeah, yes. It's really, really good. I have to give this... a solid 9 out of 10 chemical bags.
I really, really liked
this. I'm
going
to hell for that one, aren't I?
Yeah, sure. Yeah, I really, really liked this film, but it took me a little while to decide how much I liked it. There was never a point I disliked it. It was just kind of, where are you going, movie, for the first two acts of this? You know? It's like, this is interesting, but where's the point I feel like I feel like I should already be feeling something, and I'm not yet.
Is it because you knew you probably would be in the third act?
I don't know. Actually, it's a totally valid question. Maybe it was a sort of like me, I'm being a man, I'm choking it down. No, but no, I don't think so. It wasn't really connecting with me emotionally, but it was intellectually. I was like, this is a fascinating work of art that you're building here. But in the third act, I was like every other critic who saw this film. I was just, I broke down. I was just like all very deeply emotional at the end of this. I was like a big lump in my throat. Like, fuck you, Monster Calls. How dare you? There's been already too many films that have had this effect on me at Fantastic Fest alone. Say,
especially if you saw it at Fantastic Fest. Like, I don't come here to feel feelings. Yeah. I come here to,
to watch people die spectacularly. Yeah. But by the way, there is also, if you go back and look to the Infestation series of podcasts on our site, JC and I do a previous Fantastic Fest review of this movie right after we saw it. If you were like, I haven't had enough reviews of Monster Calls. If that's a thing that you experience, and that's there. I really like this. I didn't think it was quite as great as it could have been, but it was still pretty damn great. I give it 8 out of 10 tree puns I didn't make during this review. And
were there tree puns you didn't make in this review?
Oh, they were building up.
Tell us later.
Oh my god, my bark was so much worse than my bite. See, I'm just saying.
You're rooted in failure.
Nice! I didn't even see that one coming. Hey guys, you might want to check out our new Deliberations of Doom podcast this year with a group of people. We're going to be talking about the best of horror in 2016, of which not just our own picks for best of horror, but taking a look at what a lot of other critics picked for their best of the list, a few of the worst of, and then even a few television shows and upcoming stuff to look forward to in 2017 that maybe some of us saw on festivals. Either way, here's a just real quick look with our group of critics that we will be talking on the podcast and giving what their personal favorite was for 2016. So take a look and listen to the podcast, which to do so, you have to be a subscriber at Oneofus.net, a brown coat subscriber, and it is well worth it, my friends.
My name's Philip Guzman, and my favorite horror of the year would be Autopsy of Jane Doe.
Hello, this is Patience Robinson-Campos, and my favorite horror movie of 2016 was The Witch.
I'm Russ Summers, and my favorite horror movie of 2016 was Hush.
My name is Rob Summers, and my favorite horror movie of this year was the 2016 presidential election. Does that count? Does that count?
That was awesome.
Yeah, but if your second would be...
Oh, my second favorite would be Green Room.